Not necessarily. Not today. It primarily because you worry about people's lives and you don't want to put anybody in harm's way. But there is a high to it. That's why we do it. We're ready to exercise and flex our meteorological muscle skills. Nice. HITV-TV. It was HITV, Hamburg Instructional Television.
You did that as a 10th grader, 11th grader?
I did it as 9th, 10th, and 11th. And then I was out. I was kicked out 1 year because I was doing impersonations of the principal. And he said, I told everyone we had a senior alternative plan. And the senior alternative plan was that you can let seniors go out and roam if they had permission by their parents, all that stuff. Yeah. And they had taken it away because of a prank that happened that the principal kind of banned him. So I went on off camera and I did his impersonation. It was Charlie Young, and I did that for him. So their payback when I went to get my diploma, when I graduated, was not to have a diploma in there. They never called me, and that was their little joke on me. But it was all in good fun.
So you got fired in high school.
I got fired in high school. That's a true story, yes.
That pretty much prepares you for the television industry, doesn't it?
Yes, it does. It does. And if it hasn't happened to you, you haven't been in it long enough. And I went from Buffalo, New York. I was interning and freelancing at IVB. It's a CBS affiliate. And I was a union station. And I had a girl named Maria Gennaro, who's now back up there. She was in Miami. And a guy named Joe Giovenco, who was a union guy. Because those are union shops up there. And they took the time to help me make a tape and a resume. And I did it on there while I was working radio across the hall. And he got in trouble and he lost a day's pay. And I said, gosh, Joe, if there's anything I can do, I go, let me take you to lunch or do anything, man. I feel really bad. You made this tape for me. He goes, Bob, don't worry about it. But there is something you can do. You're going to Binghamton, which was my first full-time weather job. And that was in 89 and 90. And before I came here to Columbus the first time, I said, sure. He goes, could you drop my dog off to my parents in Binghamton, New York? Because they live there. I said, no big deal. I guess I'll have to let him out. He goes, no, he's real easy to deal with. So I pick up this dog, and the dog's not alive. This is a dog that was already brought to the taxidermist, and he's in the back of I had a little wagon then, and I'm driving on the old Cellenteer Expressway, now Interstate 17 in downstate New York, and I'm looking in the rearview mirror all night, and I see this image of a dog, and I'm like, Cujo, Stephen King is racing through my brain, and I'm like, this ain't good. So that was that's what he said. So all you have to do is that, and I did. I brought it to his dad, and we're all even. I did some movies. I did Fear and Loathing in Las Vegas and a couple of TV commercials, Miller Beer.
What movie?
Fear and Loathing in Las Vegas, Hunter Thompson's.
Oh, you did Fear and Loathing?
Oh, I'm in it. I'm in Fear and Loathing.
You are?
I'm in the mid-400 scene with some big old sideburns here, Camel cigarette, and I'm hugging a girl, and I'm in there for about 4 seconds, which took 3 days to shoot in Gene, Nevada. So when I was there in Vegas for that time doing this, I got to the point where I'm like, you know what, guys? I'm just... I really got to say, that things are going so good, I'm going to renew again. That's what I thought. They renewed me, but they put me to weekends. And I got off my Monday through Friday show that was going up to number one. Well, they want to take it over the edge because it's a metered market. This isn't metered here, it's diary. Meters, you can get quick hits. So, new GMs come in and news directors, they want to show their mark. Mark took me out to lunch 2 weeks before that. And I'm thinking, this is where he goes, he's picking my brain. I go, hey, hope you're not trying to take my job, laughing, haha. He goes, oh, never. He took my job. 2 weeks later.
Same guy.
I wasn't as nice, but I thought about it later, and it really is the best thing that ever happened. There's a reason for everything.
How'd you get home? How'd you come back to Columbus?
Yeah, it was my mother-in-law, as I was saying, Robin can identify with this, old Sicilian mama, and she's traditional Catholic. I use tradition. I'm a Catholic, but there's a lot of traditions in Catholicism. She's doing the rosary and she's praying, and I came home. She was there for my daughter's baptism that we had. And she was sitting in the living room. I go, Mom, I go, what are you praying about? She goes, you need to be doing this more. I said, I pray. I got myself. She goes, oh, you need to do this. She goes, well, I'm praying to get you back home. I want my daughter back home. I go, well, good. Keep praying. I said, I'm thinking, they're never going to can never afford, Columbus can never be able to pay me what I'm making out here. I'd love to come home. And yeah, I did. I made a contact a couple of years ago with a guy named Kyle Mims, who's at Thesis now. And I thought, well, whatever. So I drop her off at Sky Harbor International. That next day.
Best airport in America.
Best airport in America, yes. It's very easy to get around. You're right.
Best airport in America.
I totally agree with you. Yeah, absolutely. And the next thing I know, I get in, drop her off. I go to work. I'm there maybe about an hour or so. It's a bad day. It's the stupidest story they got me on. Somebody rubbed me the wrong way, and I'm always pretty good. And I thought, geez, I thought to myself, oh my gosh, phone rings. 706. Oh, it's my brother-in-law. I think it's Tim from Phoenix. So my brother-in-law. And I pick it up. I go, yeah. I go, what's up? Like that. Hey, Bob, this is Kyle Mims from WRBL. I don't know if you remember me. I go, yeah, Kyle, of course I remember you. You're from WRBL, yeah. I said, I met you in 04. I go, you and Matt Browning, he was the GM at the time. He goes, yeah. He goes, would you ever be interested in coming back to Columbus? Because I said, yeah, I suppose if it's right. I go, God, this is really, and it took me, I was taken aback. And all this is processing in my head. I'm like, wait a minute, mother-in-law just did this. Time is amazing. How about that?
You want to be out in the community as much as you can.
Absolutely.
Right?
There's no excuse why you can't. I mean, it's you know, as long as I can walk and talk and do all these good things, it's a great way to get to know your viewers. You're in a day and age now where technology, the millennials, I just came back from the American Meteorological Society conference up in Raleigh. Good statistics and good study. 8% of the millennials now, born, you know, up to 2000, are not consuming their news. They're not watching Phil Treso, myself, or Jonathan tonight on TV. Only 8% is. The others are not. So where's the rest of this people going? They're going right here. They're going right on here. They're going to Twitter, Facebook, Instagram. They're getting all their weather from there. And when I'm out there and I meet the young ones that are in their 20s and we're running, and you're capturing all this, you're like, Bob, hey man, I saw you, hey, what's going on? And you find out, they don't know me from Channel 3, they know me from this. It's incredible. And that's why the embracing of the technology and doing everything you have to do, you have to open your mind to it to be successful in doing this. Otherwise, you're gonna fall dead on your face. I would not be here as a chief meteorologist at Media General, because I wouldn't allow it, if I didn't take this kind of stance, or to take this kind of initiative to immerse myself. I've always done it. In 91, my first thing I ever did was a telethon in Binghamton, New York, and never turned back. Every city I've gone, I work with the Shade Tree Shelter for Women and Children, Battered Women and Children in Las Vegas. I was really active with them. I even dress up in costumes for the kids. It was never publicized because you couldn't, because these women were protected. But even things behind the scenes with the homeless, delivering for direct services, Meals on Wheels, running community. A lot of these runs have an attachment to some benefit. Love to do it to try to get that word out.
Well, I mean,
yeah, yeah. I'm sick to say that. I feel like this is crazy. I'm, you know, but yes. There's a, because if you're forecasting it and you knew it was coming together and nothing was really showing it, that's even a bigger high. But with all the technology and tools we have today, there's so many people, the laymen are trying to forecast too. But a lot of it comes with experience to know what models are useful. Last couple of weeks, this hasn't been working that well, hasn't been reliable. And which ones could we use to give us a more precise and more accurate, we say, resolution, a better resolution to a shorter term forecast? And we got some tools, but you still need the meteorological eye of an experienced person on staff, bottom line. Because how do you explain it? Is this a setup that typically would happen? And knowing the patterns here locally, there is truth to that. I mean, Doug Wallace, he maybe didn't have all the, you know, education we had or the experience or the tools and technology, but he had something going on. He knew the geography. He knew the area. He knew typically what happens during the season, big time. I mean, you can't beat it. My general manager is so excited about it that when we do it, now there's whatever independent research that I'm not privy of or see, but just going out in the street and talking to people speaks volumes. I mean, I don't even have to go anywhere. The 19 April tornado event, the 25th of this year event, which the tornado watch in the morning. We didn't get tornadoes that day, but we had severe.
Was that May 25th?
April. That was the end of April.
April 25th. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, the 25th was the day with all the damaging wind. The weekend before that was the tornado that came up through Fort Mitchell, the EF2.
Yeah.
And we were tracking that live on air. And that's the first time, because Kurt and I, for us to coordinate, for him to be here and me at the same time, a lot of times we don't get that. But it's a perception. You know, people see us, if I'm not here, like today something happened, it's still the first alert weather team. I instill that constantly. We're a team. It's got to be team. It's not just me. It's a team. And to help even with Cody and Carmen now, even David Reese when he was here, it's all those pieces of the puzzle that make me look good on air, because the drive that social media cannot do it yourself. And they do such a good job at it. So, but when Kurt and I, you have your two veteran guys on there, the most experienced, there's no disrespect to anybody else in the market. I mean, I'm just fortunate, but you can't touch us. I'm C. Hammer, can't touch this.